Here, here. Here. Court called order.
Is a confirmed chicken thief. He has no place in this God-fearing community. He is a vagrant. He cometh from no man knows whence. Since arriving in our midst, he has been known to do no honest work. The Commonwealth of Kentucky asks, yea, demands, that he be adjudged guilty and sentenced to 6 months on the chain gang.
Hey, boy, wake up there. Wake him up there. If anybody's gonna sleep in this court, it'll be me. Hey, wake up. Come here, boy. Here, come on over here, right there. What's your name?
Jeff Poindexter.
Poindexter?
Yeah.
Who gave you that?
Mr. Ranny.
Ranny? You mean Major Randolph Poindexter from down at Pine Bluff?
Yes, Pine Bluff.
Well, looks like you Poindexters is always getting mixed up with some chicken somehow. Hey, Sergeant, it seems like I recollect you and Major Ranny having some connection with the flesh of the fowl at one time.
You're good if we didn't. You know, Major Ranny was the fighingest soldier that ever chased a yank up a tree. You know, Billy, you and me put near starved that day when we went foraging for a snack after the Battle of Chickamauga.
Chickamauga? No, it was the Battle of Kennesaw Mountain.
There's no such a thing as Chickamauga.
Oh, you're both wrong.
I'm not wrong.
It was the summer of 63. But we were just outside of Nashville.
No, Billy's right. I remember. For us by there, Mitchell?
Yes. Your Honor, the Commonwealth objects to this digression.
Now, Senator, you know, now the point is that that the Major, he acted the part of a gentleman and a soldier, and he removed the temptation from out of our path by eating up all the fat hens in the whole bunch and leaving us nothing but a lot of old skinny Dominic roosters. You remember, boy?
Come to think of it, Billy, they were Plymouth Rocks.
There was no such a thing. There were Yankee chickens. There were Rhode Island Red.
But
I know what I could
know. Plymouth Rocks.
Your Honor!
Dominic.
Your Honor!
It was Dominic.
Is this a court of law?
I know that.
I ask you, is this a court of law?
Now, Senator. Senator, I don't get on your high horse that way. You know, we ain't in a great big hurry, but what are you charged with there, boy?
Nothing, Judge, but I wasn't there them chickens showing up. I just fishing.
Fishing? Why was you fishing?
Down Sleepy River.
Ain't no fishing Sleepy River.
Oh, so.
Ain't neither. Full of catfish.
Doc's right, Jimmy.
Yeah?
So it's why, folks, I catch good ass catfish in there. I'm lost.
There's your proof he's lying.
Here, come in. What do you use for bait?
Oh, I've got a hunk of beef liver.
Beef liver?
Yeah, I'm gonna take the beef liver and put it on the hook and chunk it out there. Let them have the first piece for nothing, see? And then you put some more on that and chunk it out there. And then they think they're gonna get that for nothing. And you catch them long as you got the liver. Mm-hmm. And I go down there all the time and I don't care nothing with that liver.
Yeah, I remember. Down there. I bet it must have been how long, you know?
No, sir. I
got to take down the judge's clothes. Got to take 'em in the house, yes, Lord. Got to get out that old ironing board, fix 'em up for the judge to wear. Yes, Lord, that's what I'm going to do.
Is you a hand or is you ain't?
I am, Delphi.
How come you here? The judge say you up there at that college learn to be a lawyer, man.
Aunt Dilsey, I got stomach trouble.
Law help you, white child. What them Yankees been feeding you?
Not a darn thing. That's the trouble. What have you got for supper?
Mr. Rome, you stay here. Us is going to kill the high-stepness rooster in the yard and a great big bowl of milk gravy and grits.
And waffles?
Don't you worry none, honey. You's home now. Miss Rome home. Miss Rome home. Miss Rome home. Miss Rome.
Hey, Uncle Billy!
Hiya.
Well, if it ain't Rome. Well, salt me down. What happened up there? Did them Yankees kick you out of that law school?
Sure they did. With a diploma. You're now looking at a full-fledged member of the bar.
Let me look at you. Full-fledged, my gizzard. Yeah, lawyer. You know, you better get your britches half sold, because you're going to sit around a long time before you get your first client.
Well, I don't mind, Uncle Billy.
You know what happened to me before I got my first client, don't you? Lord, I sat through two Republican administrations before I...
Who are you playing?
Oh, I'm just doing a little practicing here for the championship. I got Jeff here. He's doing the retrieving for me. Me and Herman Felsberg is going to play against Jimmy Bagby and Doc Lake. Two of them balls down there, will you, Jeff?
Two games? Mm-hmm. Remember the last time?
Mm. I'm going to show you what had happened to Jimmy Bagby now. He's, just want to show you how far I can...
look at...
Look at them Yankee shoes. You got all that, Jeff? Look at that.
Yes, I never seen shoes with buttons on them before. I seen pants, but...
Oh, say, that's fine.
Just take your button shoes with you and just step that off and see just how far it is.
All right,
I think that's about a record.
One, two, three, four. Hello?
Rome.
Glad to see me?
Why, I thought you were still up north.
I got in this morning.
How'd you know I was back here?
Well, I didn't, but Uncle... Why, you look pretty with those things.
Isn't this a lovely spray?
Mm-hmm. Now, young lady, I want to ask you a question.
Please let me down, Rome.
Miss Gillespie, will you please tell this court why you didn't answer my letters?
I've got to go in. Really, I have.
Now tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you...
You know why.
All I know is that you've changed since I went away.
Well, that isn't it, Rome. It's just that we've grown up.
You mean you don't like me anymore?
Oh, Rome.
Well, if my mother or anybody has said anything... Oh, Ellie Mae, I mean... Well, I'm old enough to choose my own friends.
Please let me go.
We've got to get this thing settled once and for all.
I've got to go in, really, I have.
All right, then. I'm coming back tonight and find out what it's all about.
You can't. I have an engagement.
Who with?
Fleming Talley.
Well, how about tomorrow night?
Oh, Rome, it's no use.
All right. That's the way you feel about it. You can sit right there till we understand each other.
That's all right. That's all right. We don't need no more practice for them old men. Besides, that exertion calls for a jeweler.
Yes, but you don't wait for that young gentleman for you.
Wait for him? Unless young folks has changed since I was skirmishing around. He won't be back for quite a while.
Look at that goat.
Ain't that a pretty sight?
What, that goat?
There ain't nothing pretty in the world than two young folks in love in the spring.
Do about that goat?
Oh, goat. My Lord, ain't you got any sentiment? Ain't you got no girl? Ain't you ever, wasn't you ever in love? Tall stand around here talking about a goat or something.
But your miss.
What about my miss?
A goat in your miss bed.
It's in my miss bed?
A goat.
Yeah.
A goat. Acting like you.
Get him out.
Get you home with you. Don't look.
Why, William Priest.
Oh, hello, Carrie.
This is a fine how do you do. What will the neighbors say? I'm ashamed of you. What's ailing you now?
That gum goat come in here and eat up my mint bed there. I bet he must have been the ruination of a million juleps.
You and your precious mint juleps. A circuit court judge. Where's your dignity?
Dignity? I don't reckon the Priest family will ever have to worry about dignity, Carrie. Not as long as you're alive and kicking.
Well, it's a good thing somebody in this family has pride.
I always told my brother when he married you that he saved the family name.
Well, if he were living, he wouldn't be fooling around the front yard with a goat. That's not what I came for. Have you seen Rome?
Oh, Rome? Rome? Oh, appears like I did see that son of yours around here a while ago. I expect he's downtown, though, now. You know, strutting around, showing off his button shoes.
Now, don't you play possum with me. As if I didn't know you'd been encouraging that girl over there to set her cap for Rome.
Carrie, if I didn't know that you had the biggest heart of any woman in the world, I'd think you're the most suspicious creature that ever come down the pipe.
Never mind that. You come up on the porch. I want to talk to you.
If I'd have known that's the way you felt about it, I wouldn't have hurried home so fast.
I'm sorry, Rome. After all, you have your career, your family, and everything in the world that matters to you right here.
I don't think you care what matters to me.
That's not fair, Rome. After all, I'm only telling you for your own good.
William, I'm not a woman to beat about the bush. This business of Rome and that girl next door has got to stop.
What do you got against Ellie Mae? She's an awful sweet girl, seems to me. She's got gumption and she teaches school and supports herself.
I don't want to be unkind. She may be a very nice girl and all that. But after all, Rome is one of the Kentucky priests. And the name of priest means something in Kentucky.
Well, I've never heard that it meant intolerance.
It means good stock and family pride. Do you know the kind of stock she comes from?
Yeah. Her ma come to this town penniless and died, giving birth to Ellie Mae. I remember the night. She was a frail little woman. Wasn't any bigger than Ellie Mae is now. And just as pretty.
But who was her father?
Well, nobody don't rightfully know.
Well, a family may not mean anything to you, but it means a whole lot to me. I'm not going to have my grandchildren come into the world under a cloud.
You haven't by any chance picked Hart Maydew as a grandpappy, have you?
Oh, I know you've never liked Senator Mayhew, but you can't say anything against his folks. They've got money, they're an old family, and Virginia's a lovely girl. She's always been crazy about Rome. He could do a lot worse.
Well, I guess me and Rome, we ain't got anything to say about it.
I knew you'd come around to my way.
You gonna stay for supper, ain't you, Carrie?
Not tonight, thank you, William. The Daughters of the Confederacy are having a chicken supper at Cape Maydew's, and I'm late already.
Looks like you daughters are getting more ferocious every year towards Yankees and fried chicken. You got your badge on there.
Yes.
Mighty pretty.
Good night, William.
Sometimes I think you women got more badges and medals out than the soldiers did. Good night, Carrie.
Listen, that old whippoorwill calling his mate. Him and his kin has been nesting around here for now on 30 years.
It's a lonesome kind of sound, isn't it, Uncle Billy?
It is so. You know, the good Lord never meant for nobody, either man or bird, to live by themselves.
Uncle Billy, why didn't you come and live with us after Aunt Margaret died?
Oh, I never could stand your ma's cooking. Awful fine swing over there on that old porch. I wouldn't be surprised if they ain't pretty girls sitting in it now.
He's got another fella tonight.
Ellie Mae sure is pretty. Fella gets her, will certainly have to do some prancing, he can't sit around and look glum all the time.
There he is now.
Who?
That Flem Tally.
The barber?
Yeah.
Gives awful poor shade, that fella.
Whoa, baby.
There ain't nothing will get your mind off women folks like work. Will you run back in my library there and get my old Kentucky Code of Statutes? It's an old calfskin book up on the top shelf there.
Yes, 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 yes.
It gets me, that brand there. Long years, I'm just gonna see if I can't stop him.
Gabby Rives and Joe Herringer, you know, the boys that work for me down at my barber shop. Well, they comes to me tonight and wants me to go over to Old Town. Some high-flying gal over there. But I tell them no. I can have all the fun I want right here at home. Now, guess who I was talking about?
Couldn't I make you some lemonade?
Lemonade? Sure, honey. And I got something to sweeten it with. Right out of the mountains and kick it like a mule.
Yeah, oh yeah, you see anything of Mr. Flem Tally, the barber man around here?
No, what'll he be doing around here?
I don't know, Judge, but they're headed this way for him.
What are you talking about? Who's they?
Some lady's pappy and a two-barrel shotgun. He said Miss Tally's been messing around. He sure is in a killing mood.
You mean that he's going to annihilate him?
No, sir. He just going to shoot him. That's all.
Well, ain't a thing that I can do about it. My job don't stop until they've got him all laid out in the mall, full of buckshot, cold and dead.
and ready for burial. Then I steps in.
But you, Judge, you are the law.
Oh, I can't do a thing about it, as I said before, until the shooting is over. And then I'll certainly see that the murderer gets a fair trial.
That book anywhere.
What book?
That Kentucky law book.
Oh. Maybe I didn't have one. Ellie Mae is waiting for you over there.
What?
Seen the flowers looking better this time of year. People are funny things. Always got their eyes set on something. Rome, he's got his eyes set on Ellie Mae, and Carrie, she's got her set on old Hod Maydew's daughter, Perone. Old Hod, he's got his eyes set on my job. Some of them's gonna be disappointed. Mm-hmm. Them honeysuckles sure do smell sweet. Seem like I just can't get my nose full enough of them. Over that grave. match at Ellie Mae's mother's.
You're
a pretty boy, though.
Yes,
sir,
you is.
Hi, Jimmy.
Hello, Billy.
What are you doing there?
Thinking on getting called to the colors again?
Hello, Gillis.
Well.
Never know what them Yanks is going to do. We licked them once, and I'm keeping old Deadeye ready in case we got to do it again.
Say, better look at old General Forrest there. Think he's going to need a little shoeing pretty soon.
Well, I'm mighty busy right now, Billy, shoeing them two horses over there. Hey, Bob, we better take a look at the judge's horses or something. Have a sniff, sir. Good corn. You can smell the feet of the boy that plowed it.
That breath of yours is like a hot mince pie.
Where you going?
One fishing. Sleepy River.
Sleepy River? Why don't you fish in the trough there?
Need chewing?
No. All right for a while yet.
Hey, bad scar you got there. Bullet?
Yeah.
Get that in warm?
No.
Folks say you come up north. Must have got that up there. We'll talk to Jeff first, find out anything.
Hey, wake up here. Somebody come along, steal the horse, and leave you sitting here holding on.
All right, come on with that beef liver now.
Oh, the bait and bait bag. Oh, they're keeping his head.
Hurry up now.
A liver.
Don't tell me you ain't got it.
He looks like that liver then walked off by itself.
Lord. Yeah. I'm not going to catch any catfish and ain't got no bait. Take this dime now and hurry on back to town and get me that beef liver.
Sir.
Hurry up now.
Actually running now. Well,
you going to put your shoes on?
Well, I'm saving them in case my feet wear out. And then I have them.
Much sitting around as you do, it won't be your feet that'll wear out.
Master Jesus wrote me a note. He wrote it on the wall. He tell me to put on my Sunday clothes, for he's coming to fetch me soon. Master Jesus wrote me a note. He
good old pretty vest hanging up in there doing nothing.
Fine crabs. Mm-hmm. Well, plague take you, I thought I told you to stay away from that vest.
Yeah, but Judge, it got hung up on
my... Yeah, you got my coat on there, too.
Yes, but this old skunk coat...
Skunk coat?
I mean possum.
What do you mean possum?
Rabbit.
Rabbit? Say, listen, every inch of that is raccoon. Better be raccoon. I took it off a rich Yankee. Now you get in there and put them things away from there. Better get on over at that festival there. Dilsey might be needing you, too.
How are you, Judge?
Just tolerable, Edward. Just tolerable.
I'm afraid it takes ice cream and cake to get you old soldiers out of church.
If the Lord ever gets in a jam, why, he knows who to call on.
That's right. Going to church isn't everything there is to it. Evening, Senator.
Good evening, Reverend. Good evening, Judge Breeze.
Good evening, Odd.
There's one of our best churchgoers.
Yes, it's surprising how far some men will go to get a few votes. Too bad we didn't get rid of him and get him off up to Congress there after him spending that term in the state Senate.
I understand he thinks you deprived him of that honor.
Me? Great Democratic Party and Thomas Jefferson.
Evidently the senator doesn't see it that way. Tell me that his cases in your court have taken on the appearance of a personal feud now that he's a candidate for your job.
Oh, I wouldn't say that, Ashby. But I am going to have to get out and do some mighty tall lectioneering, you know. Hart is he's a spellbinder and a silver tongue from way back. I'm just an old country jake, kind of a baby kisser. I ain't got much to offer the boys in the way of rhetoric.
Understand he doesn't approve of your grammar.
My grammar? First thing I learned in politics was when to say ain't.
Speaking of ice cream, did I ever tell you about Shiloh?
Yeah.
Wait a minute, Doc. How did you hear this? Well, come here. Come on back here. I want to hear this. It was the eve before Shiloh, and them orders had to get across the river to General Beauregard. What did I do? I took off my clothes and I stuffed the orders in my mouth and I pointed in. It was pitch dark. Well, sir, I was going.
Here we are. Swimming again, Jimmy?
Where was I?
Right in the middle of the river.
Yes, sir. There you are. Swimming in 12 miles to go yet. And there I was. Swimming, diving under and around Yankee gunboats all around me. Surrounded by Yankee gunboats and me dodging them. Right in.
Gunboats?
Yes.
Putting them gunboats in there is a new tack, ain't it, Jimmy?
Now, don't you young people think you have to entertain us old folks?
That's right. Run along now. They're getting ready for the candy pool. Perhaps Rome has other plans.
Oh, no, he hasn't. I declare, Virginia gets prettier every time I see her.
And I know you're happy to have Rome at home again. Oh, he's such a nice boy. Don't they look fine together? Look at them, Horace.
Ah, yes. Youth, beauty. I remember when I first crossed the threshold of my young manhood and listened to the sweet murmurings of my heart.
Double portion, please.
You have a full portion there.
Oh, but we can pay for it. Can't we, Rome?
Gentlemen, I propose to conduct my campaign on a dignified basis. No personality. Others may censure the homespun manners of Judge Priest on the bench. Not I. Others may question the method by which he has held political control of the county for a quarter of a century. Not I. So, gentlemen, merit alone will count in the forthcoming election.
Where have you been keeping yourself, Joe? I think you've forgotten where I live.
Nothing like that.
Mother and Daddy are always teasing me about you. I tell them you don't care anything about me. That you have a girl up north.
Well, even if I did have, haven't you got every boy in town on your string?
Oh, those stick in the mud. They make me tired. Besides, I've been waiting for somebody else.
Attention! Say, what's the prettiest gal at the festival here, moping around back here by herself, huh?
You want some taffy, Judge?
I ain't much of a taffy puller. On second thoughts, you can give me a wad of that, too.
Try it. Put the butter on your hands first.
Hello, Uncle Billy.
Oh, no. You ain't doing that right.
What's the matter with it?
Here. Let me see your hand. You ain't got no butter on there, no wonder. Here, let me show you. Put mine in here, let me show you. There, go on up there, run on up there and put some more stickum on your hand there. Go on, right up there.
All right, Uncle Billy.
That's it, now here, put that right over in there now. Now, that's one. That's the thing, candy pulling, you got to keep your mind right on there. Look at this, that's how you're getting it all on your hand. Keep your mind on what you're doing there now. Lord, you pulling candy with the champion candy puller of this neighborhood now. Good morning, Mr.
Morning.
Nice day.
Yeah.
Oh, Flynn, here she comes. And does she like her Flemish?
Hey, Flem, when you two getting hitched?
Don't know it, I heard nobody talking about marriage.
You ain't scared of no shotgun wedding, are you?
Not as long as she ain't got no paw.
Say. That fellow's going to make himself mighty unpopular around here.
That's right, Judge.
Yeah. There's about 2,000 male citizens here that's going to be mighty sore at him.
Yeah.
When they find out that he punched you in the jaw before they could. Yes, he's going to be awful unpopular around here.
Don't see you around much.
No.
Trying to keep to yourself, don't you?
Yeah.
Joe, get some old beer while I lock me that 14 ball down there in the corner.
Oh, I'll pay for it.
Hey, Bill, Gillis is out there.
Yeah?
Yes.
Come on, Mr. Gillis.
No, hold your horses now. He'll be heading through you in a minute, going home.
You fellas with me?
Sure. Sure with you.
Another?
Nope.
How the South ever lost the war with a guy in it could argue like you did.
Uncle Billy.
What is the matter? You've already made me lose the game.
Uncle Billy, I got a client.
Oh, well, who is it? What's the matter with him?
Gillis, you know, Mr. Bagby's man.
Huh? What's that, Bob Gillis? What's he doing?
He cut up Flem Talley.
Yeah?
Uh-huh, and right after he gave himself up, he sent for me.
Well, I'll be kicked by a mule. Did you cut him bad?
Well, I can't tell yet. Gee, Uncle Billy, he sent for me. It'll be the biggest case in your whole court session, and I'll be defending him.
I wouldn't gloat too soon now.
Oh, don't you worry. Hey, Ellie Mae!
See, yeah, I'm going to get down to the jail and see what that fella's got to say for himself.
I'm going to see Tully.
Darn robbers, they robbed us out of that. Herman, now, you better get on down there with me because you're liable to get a chance to go as bail.
Ellie Mae! Ellie Mae, I got a client.
You would.
Come on over. I want you to talk to Uncle Billy and tell you all about it.
That's sort of novelty, Herman. The barber getting cut up. If you ever cut him up, couldn't have cut him much if he used the barber razor.
Where's Rome? I won't have it, that's all. He's getting mixed up with that kind of people.
Oh, what's he done now?
Well, he's done enough.
Mother, what's the matter? Something wrong?
If you're in the habit of discussing your affairs before strangers, I'm not.
Well, Ellie Mae's not a stranger.
Excuse me, Rome, I'll go.
No, wait.
All right. I have nothing to hide.
Carrie, what's the matter? Have you been out in the sun too much?
Shut up, William Priest. I hold you responsible for everything that's happened. Are you going to defend that man?
Mr. Gillis? You bet I am.
Oh, no, you're not.
Mother, what do you mean I'm not?
I suppose you know what's behind this drunken brawl? No? Well, then I'll tell you. They were fighting over that girl in a saloon.
Mother, that's not so.
Carrie, you can accumulate more misinformation in a shorter time than anybody. Who told you all this rigmarole?
Virginia made you.
Who?
Virginia made you.
Oh.
She got it straight from her father.
And brought it straight to you.
She wanted to warn Rome. I know you've never liked me, Mrs. Priest. I know you've tried to stop Rome from going with me. And I know you think I'm not good enough for him. But let me tell you something. If Rome were half as mean as you are, he wouldn't be good enough for me. Well, of all things.
Cat? Looks like you run second.
Oh, no, I don't. If Rome's father were alive, he'd back me up. Rome's already got himself talked about all over town with this girl, and I'm not going to have him publicly defending her in court.
Well, Rome, see how your mother feels about it, so looks like you lost your first client. It's certainly hard to get, too.
No, Uncle Billy, I haven't lost anything.
Rome!
Mother, I think I'm old enough to know my own mind. I said I'd defend Mr. Gillis, and I'm going to go through with it.
Political and personal difference has existed between your honor and myself. Now that I am a candidate for the exalted office which you have held for so many years, those differences have reached a point where, for the protection of the people, I must demand an impartial trial judge.
Perhaps I'm getting deaf, but the fact had never reached me before. Are you insinuating that you won't get full justice in this court?
I maintain that my language was sufficiently plain for any comprehension, however obtuse. And I will make it even franker. I charge, in the presence of two witnesses, you took sides with defendant Gillis in a prior attack upon this plaintiff.
I've been sitting on this bench for nigh on 20 years, and nobody has ever asked me to step down.
I'll file an affidavit of prejudice.
That won't hardly be necessary.
Then I call upon you, Judge Priest, to vacate the bench during this trial and yield your place to a qualified judge.
I'm not denying, Senator, that you kind of took my breath away. I guess I had just sort of got the habit that I was took for granted here on this bench. Gosh, I was not putting you raised in this courtroom. When I quit fighting, 65, for what we thought was right, I kind of calmed down, found out I couldn't lick the whole United States, come back here to my hometown. And I put up my shingle. It wasn't long before I was sitting on that bench. Maybe I did have a hankering for the spirit of the law, not the letter. But as far as I know, nobody ever found cause to complain till now. Now, you jury, you forget everything that I've said. And my feelings has no place in the records of this trial. Now, if you'll excuse me, either side has any objection, I'd like to ask the Honorable Floyd Fairley, if he won't come up here and take my
my place on the bench.
Upon these three worthy citizens.
I object, Your Honor. I deny that my client ever burst into any place or anything.
Objection sustained. So be it, Your Honor. Nevertheless, I shall demonstrate that my young friend's client here did burst into something. That armed with a lethal weapon, to wit, a dirk, dagger, or knife of deadly length and deadly sharpness, he burst into Mr. Tarley's quivering flesh.
I object, Your Honor.
Objection sustained. Your Honor's humble servant bows to Your Honor's august ruling. In due time, Mr. Tarley's scarred and mutilated person will bespeak the verity of my claim with a silent eloquence far exceeding the powers of my poor tongue.
We was playing bottle pool when he come in and attacked me.
Didn't you attack him with a billiard cue?
Not until after he come at me with a knife.
Well, it's just like Flem says. We wasn't paying him no mind and he come looking for Flem.
But weren't you three all armed with billiard cues?
Well, never heard of nobody playing pool without them.
It's just like Flamin' Joe says. He come in looking for trouble.
You don't like the defendant, do you?
Who does?
Your Honor, the defense is through with the witness.
I should think my young learned colleague would be glad to be through with the witness. Your Honor, the prosecution rests.
Before the defense proceeds, this court recesses for half an hour.
I don't know why you did it, Mr. Gillis. But Judge Priest told me what happened in the barbershop. Oh, you've got to tell the jury.
They'd never convict you in a million years if they knew you were defending a girl's name.
Don't you see? You can't think of me now. You've got to think of yourself.
Look, Mr. Gillis, I don't want to bring Ellie Mae's name into this thing any more than you do. But she's right. They can give you 10 years for assault. The way Maydew's working on the jury, they'll give you the limit.
Well, you've got to tell the truth, Mr. Gillis. Don't you see? You've got to.
I ain't gonna tell him anything. Yes, sir. Tally lied all the way through. And Herringer and Gab Rise, they lied too. It was 3-1 in Billy Gaynor's back room, and it's 3-1 in this here courtroom.
Have you ever been in any other cutting scrape in town before?
No, sir.
That's all.
One moment. Where do you come from, Mr. Gillis?
I ain't a saying.
You aren't exactly what we Southerners would call a sociable person, are you?
I mind my own business.
Precisely. Except when you go looking for trouble.
I don't go looking for trouble. But I ain't the one to run away from it.
How long have you had a grievance against Mr. Tally?
We had a run-in a few days before he jumped me.
Oh, a run-in, eh? And what was this run-in about?
Well, well, come on, tell the jury. What did you hate him for?
I had to see him.
Then you didn't have any reason for knighting.
I didn't say that.
Well, make up your mind. Why did you hate him?
I had to see him.
Oh, Your Honor. Anything further?
That's all, Your Honor. The defense rests.
This court will adjourn till tomorrow morning. It is our hope that the summations will be brief, so that we may all attend the reunion ceremonies, which begin at noon.
This is a pleasure. I don't get a chance to do this often. You certainly does me honor. Here, Jeff, make the Reverend comfortable there. It looks like you kind of caught me red-handed there. Yes. Well, could I, kind of inveigle? Been a long, tiresome day, and it's mostly mint.
No, thank you, William. I appreciate your sympathy.
You know, I kind of thought that that you'd be working on your Memorial Day address for tomorrow.
Well, that'll take care of itself. What I'm worried about is this poor devil of Gillis.
You know Gillis?
My trade takes me into queer quarters sometimes.
Well, I feel just as sorry for that fella Gillis as you do. I'm plumb out of it. Hard got the best of me. He sure did. Case is closed. It's all settled. And I don't think Hard will... he'll be fool enough to reopen the case for nobody or nothing.
William, I have a duty to perform. A Christian's duty. I'm going to violate the sacred confidence of another. I'm going to break a pledge of secrecy because it's the only course that I see that lies before me.
I'm listening, Ashby.
25 years ago,
the judge has sure been hard misery. Reckon folks ain't been acting just right. Maybe his stomach's been complaining and he needs a toddy this night.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
'Cause tomorrow he's got to be like Mr. Samson.
Saving Daniel from the lion's den.
Saving Daniel from the lion's den.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. The judge could do it, I thought it right now.
Yes,
yes. Yes, they'll see soon as you get me some men. Oh, Jeff. Jeff.
Come on, come on, hurry up here. Come on here when I holler at you. Where you been?
Well, I was...
Hey, listen, you want to earn that old coonskin coat of mine?
I can have that coon coat, Judge. Thank you,
Yeah, wait a minute. Come back here. You can if you do everything I tell you to. Do you know a gentleman by the name of Mr. Hart Maydew?
Yeah, that mean man, that coat hurts.
Yeah, well, now you see that he gets that, but don't you let him know how he got there,
see? That's all I got to do, yeah.
Oh, say, wait a minute. Can you play Dixie on that thing there?
Well, that coon coat. Yes, I played Dixie with Marching Through Georgia.
Oh, way ahead. Marching Through Georgia. Yeah. I got you out of one lynching.
Yes, but for that coon coat, I know what I was going to
get.
Get
you playing Marching Through Georgia, I'll join the lynchers. We lost the bass drum.
How could you lose a bass drum?
Someone stole it. We need it for the parade.
You may begin your summation, Mr. Prosecutor.
May it please your honor. Since adjournment yesterday, certain information has come into the hands of the Commonwealth, which, in the interest of justice, impels me to reopen the case. The Commonwealth desires to recall the defendant Gillis for further cross-examination.
Very well, Mr. Maydew. Proceed.
Robert Gillis, take the stand.
Your Honor, as I recollect our procedure, for the time being, I'm an ordinary member of the bar. In good standing?
Not ordinary, sir, but absolutely in good standing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, kindly. Then I have the honor of announcing myself as associate counsel for the defense. Seeing as the case has been reopened.
Mr. Gillis, were you always a man of turbulent and violent nature?
I always left them alone as left me alone.
Is that so? What was the name of the man you once upon a time murdered?
I never looked on it as no. No, it wasn't murdered.
A man was killed, wasn't he?
Yes.
And they stuck you in jail, didn't they?
Yes.
And they charged you with murder, didn't they?
Yes.
And the jury found you guilty, didn't they?
Yes.
Were you sentenced to be hung?
No, I went up for life.
Did you escape or were you pardoned?
I ain't a-saying. And I won't tell you no more, no matter what you ask me.
You don't need to. Judge Priest, your witness.
No questions, Your Honor.
But Uncle Billy,
hasn't the defense any evidence to offer in rebuttal, Judge Priest?
One character witness, Your Honor. Mr. Clerk, will you kindly call Reverend Ashby Brand?
Brand.
Do you solemn swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in the case now pending in this court?
I do.
Reverend Brand, before you come to this town, what was your occupation?
In my early manhood, before I took holy orders, I had the honor to be a captain of artillery in the late war.
In the war of the rebellion?
No, sir. The war for the Southern Confederacy.
Yes, sir. You're right, sir. That's right. He's right.
One moment, please, Your Honor. I yield to no man in love and everlasting devotion to that sacred lost cause for which my people fought and bled. But though I cherish all those dear and everlasting memories which even the bare mention of that great conflict must awaken in every true Kentuckian's bosom, I fail to see any possible connection between this reverend gentleman's military record and the guilt of this man, Gillis.
Thank
legal error by allowing a minister of the gospel to tell his story in his own way.
Meander along, Reverend Brand.
As many of you know, I am a Virginian. On the day my state seceded from the Union, I enlisted. I was a private in Penn's Virginia Battery. By the latter end of the third year, I was in command of that battery. All the officers ranking me had been killed or disabled. We lost heavily at Chancellorsville. And at Fredericksburg, we were almost wiped out. We kept our field pieces. We kept our pieces until the end. But we'd not sufficient men to man those guns, nor anywhere to turn for more men. There were no more men left to come in. The Confederacy in 64 was robbing both the cradle and the grave for cannon fodder. Well, sir, I got temporary leave and went to Richmond to see our war governor. I said to him, sir, I've come to you to ask for men to serve my guns. He laughed and said, tell me where they're to be found. I said, among the chain gangs from the state penitentiary. He said, you've come too late, young man. I've freed every convict that might conceivably be trusted with freedom. There are left only the lifers, and I dare not turn loose. They are working under guard, building defenses for you to fight behind. He opposed me, but I argued with him. Finally, I won. He gave me authorization, signed it, and with his own hand, affixed the seal of the sovereign state of Virginia. I rode back to the line, sir, and I found my chain gang. I told them to drop their tools and line up before me. I told them, if you go with me, you go to face a hell of destruction and suffering and death. But I said, if you do go, you go as free men, as soldiers of the Confederacy. Your past will lie behind you, and your future, if you survive, is in your own hands. And I promise you this much, if you stand fast, if you do your duty, if bravely and honorably you acquit yourselves as men, then such of you as live through to the end, and some of you will live, are not to come back to this. It's for you to decide. Those who remain behind, stand fast. Those who come with me, advance one pace. Gentlemen of the jury, I tell you, they came at me like a wave from the sea, every one of them. And as time went on, they won for themselves the name of the Battalion from Hell. The scars of their shekels still on their legs. They fought for the South like men, none better. And they died like men, most of them. I was one of those men of whom I wish to speak a special word of tribute. He stood out for his courage and his fidelity, for his worth as a soldier and a man. Most of all, for his invariable truthfulness under all circumstances. He was from the mountains of my own state, a man who spoke little, but did much. I saw him once go out under fire during a battle.
to rescue at his own risk a wounded Union officer who lay there helpless between the lines. Another time, our stars and bars was wrested from our hands. We fought breast to breast that day. This man of whom I'm speaking threw himself on a riderless horse and rode into the thick of it, and by the grace of God, came galloping back from the jaws of death, our colors clutched in his hand. And another day, when every man who served his gun, excepting him, was down, I saw him when the Union infantry charged, sitting astraddle his useless gun, and with a rammer for his only weapon, waiting for the enemy to come within reach. A countercharge from our infantry saved him. But he had stood fast, and he was alone. After the surrender, I kept his secret. Kept it to this very hour. Though I've seen him daily at his work, watching over his daughter, providing for her education through me, all unknown to Ellie Mae. Gentlemen, as a soldier, I knew that man as Roger Gillespie. You know him by the name he now wears, Robert Gillis.
Hooray for Jeff Davis, the Southern Confederacy, and Bob Gillis!
Get out of the way! Can't you see that poor, helpless child needs a mother?